you can, please, we are ready to start. Thank you. Good evening and welcome to the planning committee. My name is councillor Anita Leach and I'm the chair of the committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain to the rest of the people on the table here tonight, to my immediate right is the council solicitor who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If there is more than one petition and other people want to speak, I will be allowing that, but again it will be up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any debate that may follow by the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application this evening. The order of tonight's agenda, I would like to vary on the basis of we've got a lot of people here for certain applications, and I'll be putting that to planning committee in a moment to get some confirmation that they're happy to do that. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, this matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed at a subsequent planning meeting. Members, could I have approval of the minutes on page 1 to 12?
Yes, approved.
Okay, happy to approve those, thank you. Are there any members' declarations of interest? Steve?
Yeah, I'll declare prejudicial interest and leave the room on item number 10. And there is also an application that's been given previous approval on item 17. Both reasons for declaring interest is my role as board director at the gentleman.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Geoffrey.
Thank you, Chair. As you know, I've been called in at short notice as a deputy. In relation to item 14, Stonehive Gardens Green, members will know that I've been concerned for some time about development of the Gardens Green area in general. So I'd just like to declare that I'm happy to consider this on its merits.
Sorry, we can't hear you at the back.
Members will know that I have been concerned for some time about developments in the Darwin's Green area in general. So in relation to item 14, I'm just declaring that I am prepared to attend and consider this item on its merits.
Thank you, Geoffrey. Are there any requests for site visits? Steve?
Chair, yeah. Given the application is a HMO on item 5, I think as we develop as a committee, I think the HMO issue is one of concern, and I think all members of the committee would benefit greatly from a site visit to have a good look at this application.
Thank you, Steve. Are there any others?
Chair, what happened?
just asking now, is there a site visit request?
Chair, can I make a site visit request for item 6 for the Ship Inn on Brett Road in Wallasey, please?
Okay, so we've had a request for agenda item 5, Elmley's Discount Borough Road, and a request for the Ship Inn 208 Brett Road. Are members happy to have those? Yeah?
Yes, happy for that, Chair.
Okay, thank you. In terms of the order of today's agenda, we have quite a lot of people here for agenda items 4, 10 and 15. So I'm proposing that we do them in that order to start off with. And agenda item 16, we do have some matters which can't be discussed within the public. So I'm going to take that one at the end if that's okay with members. And lastly, we've got agenda item 13. Wasn't on the late list to say it's been withdrawn, but has subsequently been withdrawn. Okay, so are members happy to do that?
Yes, thank you, Chair.
Is item 11 withdrawn, Chair?
Yes, on the late list, item 11 has been withdrawn. So if I could just remind members of the public then that we won't be discussing these items this evening. So if you are here for those applications that I'm going to read out now, I'm quite happy that you leave now. Can you leave orderly and quickly so that we can get on with business, please? So the first one is agenda item 5, Elmley's Discount. Agenda item 6, the Ship Inn 208 Brent Road. Agenda item 11, 3-5 Tobin Street. And agenda item 13, 21 Bulls Way, Heswood. So if anybody is here for those applications this evening, I'm happy that you do leave now.
Thank you, Chair. The application for the Ansonians, there are several elements to this proposal. These include the demolition of the clubhouse and the erection of 21 houses to the north of the site, a new sports and community building, and a car and coach park. The application, it's a departure from the unit development plan. The development plan constitutes inappropriate development, which is in conflict with Green Belt policy, and should not be approved unless supported by very special circumstances that clearly outweigh the harm. The site is within the Green Belt. In addition, the site is located within the Eastern Village Conservation Area, where new development must preserve and enhance the conservation area in line with local and national policies. So the site consists of the existing rugby club, pitches and a car park. The site is bounded on two sides by the A44 to the west and Eastern Village Road to the east. The site is largely open, with sports pitches forming the bulk of the site. The existing clubhouse is a single-storey structure, which is located at the northern end of the site. The access to the small car park adjacent to the clubhouse is from Eastern Village Road. The housing element of the scheme consists of 21 detached houses, which will be set in the form of a cul-de-sac with access from Eastern Village Road. The houses are two-storey, with fairly traditional design, with variation in house types to create the varied street scene. The elements of the development which relate to the rugby club concern car parking, clubhouse and pitches. The proposed new clubhouse would be located centrally on the site to the west of the site and to the rear of the existing petrol filling station on Eastchester Road, which you can see is kind of an indent on the western side of the site. The three pitches will be laid out around the clubhouse. The clubhouse itself is proposed as a fairly contemporary two-storey building. In addition to this, to serve the development, a new larger car park is proposed, which would be alongside Eastern Village Road, in between the housing development and the existing houses, which are to the south of the site. So in terms of impact on the conservation area, the houses are positioned to the northernmost part of the site, so visually they form an extension to the existing built development across the open pitch area, car park and clubhouse. The existing trees and shrubs which form the boundary of Eastern Village Road will soften the impact of the development and afford glimpses of the new houses, which will be set back from the road. The houses are traditionally designed and have sufficient variety and appearance to fit in with the scale of development in the conservation area. The proposed position of the clubhouse is towards the western boundary, towards the rear of the existing service station on Newchester Road. The building, although in an area that's currently unbuilt on, will be viewed against the backdrop of the service station and its landscaping. It's quite a dense tree frontage to the Newchester Road side. In terms of its impact on the conservation area, the new clubhouse will provide a focal point which will make a positive contribution to the conservation area. The existing clubhouse is noted in the conservation area appraisal as being more much as a negative impact on the conservation area. The development also includes a large car park and coach park which takes access from Eastern Village Road to serve 142 cars and two coaches. The car park is located near the boundary of the road and due to the larger access will be a visible feature. It's been designed and landscaped to minimise its visual impact. However, it's likely that the parking area will be a visually intrusive feature which has a negative impact on the conservation area. This, however, we feel can be balanced with any benefit of removing much of the on-street parking generated by the working floor at match times, which is also harmful to the character of the conservation area. As the site is in Greenbelt, we also have to assess it in terms of Greenbelt policy. So the housing that forms part of the application is considered an appropriate development, as is the proposed clubhouse, floodlighting and car park, as they don't fulfil the criteria for appropriate development. The provision of outdoor pitches is considered to be appropriate development, which would be acceptable under Greenbelt. So to find these acceptable, we have to be convinced there are very special circumstances. The case submitted by the applicant for very special circumstances includes a number of factors that fundamentally revolves around the desire to retain the working club at the site, at its existing site, and provide better facilities both for the club and the wider community. The revenue from the sale of part of the club's land to provide the 21 houses would assist with funding and help secure the future of the club and ongoing maintenance costs. In addition to this, the council is seeking a suitable location to provide a replacement community facility for the youth facilities at Lindell Avenue, which are due to close. The new clubhouse provides improved facilities in terms of changing facilities and accessible facilities, which will enable much wider use of the building and site for sport, as well as providing a youth hub which is completely funded by the council to replace the facilities on Lindale Avenue. So whilst the proposed development presents an opportunity for improved outdoor sport and recreational facilities, substantial weight must be given to any harm to the Greenbelt that would arise from proposed development. The harm to the Greenbelt through loss of openness is acknowledged. However, on balance, it is considered that this is outweighed by the wider community benefits of the whole development. The proposal is recommended for approval, subject to referral to the Secretary of State and a Section 106 agreement for traffic management in the village. There are several petitions, both for and against.
Thank you, Sheila. Just in terms of the qualifying petitions against this application, can the people who are the lead petitioners identify themselves, please? Okay, would you both like to speak?
Yes, please.
Okay, can you decide between yourselves who's going to speak first? And could I ask, if at all possible, if you're going to repeat what's already been said, can you avoid doing that as much as you can? Okay, could I ask the first person to come forward, please? So you should find at the bottom of your microphone that there's a button that you can press which will switch your microphone on. When you do, can you provide your name and address, and you have up to 5 minutes to speak. When you come into the last minute, I will let you know about that. Okay?
Yes.
When you're ready.
Which is the one? Just the big green one.
The green one.
My name's David Colenso and I live in Village Road, Eastham, the ancient and medieval village of Eastham, described by Nathaniel Hawthorne, the American author, in the mid-19th century as the finest English village he'd ever seen. I've been an active member of the village church all my life. I've brought up 3 children there, been a scout leader since 1971. I'm also a heritage officer for the Eastham Village Preservation Association and have several other roles, especially in local youth work and schools. We are very fortunate that in 1922, the then Cheshire County Council upgraded the A41 Birkenhead to Chester Road and built a fine bypass, allowing the old village to remain undisturbed as it is to the present day. Practically all new development has taken place on the inland or westerly side of the A41, and subsequent decision making has always seen the old village with its whitewashed cottages, 2 pubs, sandstone school, an 800-year-old church as worth preserving within a small and very effective green girdle, now known as the conservation area. Therefore, we were very surprised that our 3 local councillors are supporting development in the conservation area, which hitherto they have vociferously opposed. I understand that one of them was on the planning committee in 2009, which welcomed the revised appraisal and management plan for Eastham Conservation Area. St. Anselm's Old Boys Rugby Club bought the land, which is now within this conservation area, sometime shortly after the war. They had no connection with Eastham Village, but got the land cheaply. It was at that time designated as the village recreation ground by the vendors, the Eastham House, who were selling over. And it's labelled on the 1906 Owen survey map as recreation ground. Have the Anselmians been good neighbours? Well, that's questionable. They've made little attempt to integrate with the village. They've neglected their land, the hedges, as litter. They've removed the small copse by the old sandstone style and the damson orchard used by the villagers for more than 2 centuries. The trees have been felled and pruned without required tree authorisation, and spring bulbs planted by villagers have been uprooted. Sadly, their hallmark has been less than good lately. These proposals will dominate the northern entrance of the village and will not only do nothing to preserve and enhance the conservation area, which is required by the conservation CH10, but on the contrary will clearly damage it. The 150-place car park and coach park will obviously need a very wide entrance, and will remove the more trees and hedges, which will mean further destruction of the appearance of the village, which conservation area status is supposed to preserve. And the council have, I understand, already agreed to spend £333,000 on a new youth club there. So as why not build it on the other side of the A41, just round the corner, on council-owned playing fields in Bridal Road? They could have 20 houses to help pay for it there. After all, the 12 football pitches or more, easily more, are underused, and they are not in the greenbelt or the conservation area, nor are there any special circumstances to worry about. I wonder what the reaction might be. It's interesting to note that for all these years, the rugby club has suddenly found that it has the interests of the community at heart. But if the club's so keen to help the community with all these promised facilities, then perhaps they should consider moving to this facility in Bridal Road, just mentioned. Finally, I come to the notion that the area lacks community and youth facilities.
Mr. Collins, you have 1 minute.
Thank you. The existing youth club is barely functioning. So to suggest that there's a community demand for this facility is nonsense, and I say this as an active youth worker in Eastham. Will moving it to the conservation really work? In my experience, I doubt it. Parents I've spoken to say they're not very likely to allow their children to cross the A41. So, there's absolutely no benefit to the people of Eastham from this proposal, outrageous proposal, only to the rugby club. And at a grave cost to the environment of this wonderful old rural village.
Thank you very much for this evening's time. Okay,
Chairman.
microphone's been left on for you, but if you can state your name and address, and again, you have 5 minutes, and I'll let you know when you have anything there.
Okay. My name is David Allen, and I'm Secretary of Eastern Village Preservation Association, which for the last 44 years has been the Conservation Area Advisory Committee for the Village. I'm also Vice Chairman of Conservation Areas Wirral. This proposal is to build an entirely inappropriate and damaging huge two-storey glass-fronted youth club stroke pavilion in the conservation area in Greenbelt. It will be enabled by the revenue of about £1 million from the sale of Greenbelt land on which 21 houses will be constructed. It violates policy CH10, the objective of which is not only to retain the distinctive character of Eastham, but also to maintain the open or woodland setting of the village and a sense of separation from the surrounding area. In the words of the report, new development must preserve and enhance the conservation area. Are you happy that 21 houses and a vast new car park preserves and enhances the conservation area? We are surprised there is no input from highways. The traffic through Eastham Village is horrendous, with commuter vehicles using the narrow roads to avoid congestion at traffic lights on the A41 and the M53 roundabout. The proposal will generate at least an extra 100 traffic movements a day to the houses and the youth club, which is quite unacceptable. Very special circumstances. According to the report, these are that the club is struggling financially due to a decline in membership and has difficulty in recruiting and retaining new members, and that the revenue from the sale of part of the club's land to provide 21 houses would assist with funding and help secure the future of the club and ongoing maintenance costs. The officer's report states that members should be aware that this is not uncommon for other sports clubs in similar circumstances. In other words, the claim very special circumstances are commonplace, or not very special at all. If this application is allowed, what is there to stop all these other sports clubs in similar circumstances from making similar applications? This is a precedent that could open the floodgates. And what proof is there that the club has many problems? The report simply states that the club has submitted evidence that it can't afford to pay the interest on the loan. Surely if the club is going to rely on financial difficulties for special circumstances, then shouldn't its books be open to rigorous examination by qualified accountants rather than the non-revealed evidence taken on trust by a planning officer? Shouldn't there be a robust business plan to back up their proposals? 5 years ago, the club persuaded the council to lease them the 3 acres of the adjacent former school playing field, and everything was financially rosy. In a letter, they said their membership was increasing, they needed more pitches, and they promised a total of 8. They said they would raise the money internally to pay for a new pavilion. They already had 50,000 towards its costs. They were in talks with their bankers and the RFU, and they would reach their target of 150,000 for the next 6 months. But what happened? Where's the money? It was on this basis that the council agreed to lease them the land, with the first 25 years being rent-free. The lease terms included the implementation of the promised 8 pitches and also a no parking clause. You may well conclude that the club is financially incompetent. In order to find land for this proposal, they have disregarded the terms of the lease and simply swapped the council land for 3 acres of their own. Needless to say, the required 8 pitches have gone out of the window, we're back down to 3, same as at present, and they want to park 143 cars on the land. The officer's report states that the arguments are finely balanced. In other words, not much to choose between them. Yet the MPPF clearly states that very special circumstances will not exist unless the potential harm to the Greenbelt is clearly outweighed by other considerations. Clearly outweighed. How does that sit with the officer's statement that the arguments there are simply finely balanced? The council's asset management section has agreed to fund this new youth club pavilion, which includes a bar to the tune of £376,000. So you may therefore well wish to query, how come the club needs the estimated £1 million from the sale of its Greenbelt land? If you reject this application, at least the club has plenty of options to reconsider its future. It has permission for a new pavilion on the site of the existing, and it has additional space for the pitches. On the other hand, if you approve the application, the 1,000-year-old village of Eastham has no such fallback. An integral part of its character will be destroyed forever. This proposal is just as bad as the Stoughton application that you rejected last month, and I urge you to reject it. Thank you.
Would the lead petitions of those identify themselves? Would you like to speak on this, sir?
Yes, please.
Would you like to come forward? Okay, could I just hang on 1 second for me? Just need some clarification in the matter. We need to hear from the applicant before we hear about decisions in favour of it. So if I could ask you to return to your seat and could ask the applicant to come forward, please.
I do represent the applicant.
So are you with the petitioner? Are you acting as petitioner or are you acting as the applicant?
I'm acting as agent for the applicant.
Right, okay. So as agent for the applicant,
yes.
Can I ask you to present your speech?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Graham Trimona. I'm a planning consultant and I act on behalf of the Rugby Club. This planning application proposes a mix of development which is particular to the site and the circumstances at the Rugby Club. The justification for the development is that it will deliver benefits for the community which outweigh perceived impact on the Greenbelt. These benefits include a secure future for the Rugby Club, which is at the heart of the community in Euston. Significant and lasting improvements to the quality and reach of facilities for sport and recreation, and the delivery of a new sports centre, a new youth centre, sorry. The ambition is to provide facilities to meet the needs of a wide range of age groups and a wide range of abilities, including male and female participants, and those with mobility impairments. We aim to improve participation in sport and respond in a direct way to the growing need for initiatives that improve health and well-being. In order for these community benefits to be realised, there is a need for some housing development. The 21 houses that are proposed will generate the funds which are necessary to build the new clubhouse, to construct the new car park, and to reconstruct the sports pitches. Financial appraisal to show that this amount of housing is needed to secure the community benefits has been provided. The financial appraisal has been independently assessed and has been shown to be sound. The layout of the development has been very carefully thought through. The new housing has been positioned so that it will be seen as an extension to the group of relatively modern buildings at the junction of Newchester Road and Eastern Village Road, whilst the clubhouse and community hub building will be viewed in the context of the petrol filling station on Newchester Road. The new clubhouse is similar to a scheme approved in 2011 but never built. At that time it was viewed as an enhancement to the conservation area. Car parking is located behind the material boundary hedge at the margin of Eastern Village Road and as such it will be screened. The overall effect is to maintain the open space around the older core of the conservation area. This is important, as the essential character of the conservation area is the cluster of historic buildings grouped around St Mary's Church, surrounded by relatively open land. This character will be maintained and the appearance of the conservation area will be preserved. The Rugby Club needs better facilities in order to fulfil its potential as a central and sustainable resource for the community. This is something that is highlighted in the Council's Playing Pitch Strategy and Action Plan, approved as recently as October 2017. This strategy puts an emphasis on better maintenance of the sports pitches, better flood lighting and a higher quality clubhouse. The proposed development will bring forward these much needed improvements and more. The addition of the community hub brings wider benefits and access to young people to high quality sports facilities. There is a unique and specific relationship between the sports field and their use by the community because there are provisions in the lease which give a right for the community to use the sports fields. The car park will also benefit the area by taking parked cars and coaches off the surrounding roads. This will assist with road safety, but it will also be a positive benefit to the character of the conservation area. Overall, the range of community benefits that will be delivered through this development must carry considerable weight in the assessment and determination of the planning application. The combination of high quality sports facilities, modern standard changing rooms, community hub for young people, and on-site car parking will provide a level of public or community benefit that counterbalances the effects of a small amount of development in the Greenbelt. In this case, there are very special circumstances to justify the development. There is a unique and compelling opportunity to create an amenity for the whole community. I respectfully request that you give support to this planning application.
Because there was more than one petition in support of this. Is there anybody else who's a lead petition would like to speak? No. Okay, thank you very much. Could I ask if there's a ward council would like to speak on this? You come forward, please. If you could just say your name for
the board. Yes, thank you, Chair. Councillor Dave Mitchell, Eastern Ward Councillor for the last 34 years. I'm speaking in favour of this application, and I'm speaking on behalf of my two ward colleagues also. I'd like to point out one or two slight errors in speeches that have been made by previous speakers, and that, first of all, can I say the rugby club itself is growing. I had the opportunity to go down on a few occasions to see how it's progressed over a few weeks. I'm really impressed by the outcome of the work that's done by the community groups in the rugby club. Last weekend, there was 150 children doing sporting activities on this pitch, on this field, I'll say that, on the field. Because at the time, when you say, contrary to a comment before, that the amount of pitches that were going to be used was not there and won't be there in the future. When you've got five-year-old boys and girls, I'll say that, it's not just boys and girls, who are practicing the rugby, the snatch rugby that they use, the tag rugby, then you use a small area of land. So you basically say one pitch, you can have four actual matches going on after a long time. The club itself does a lot of work in the community and for the community, contrary to what was said by the speakers before. I know for a fact because, as you know, I was a previous mayor of this authority. I did attend occasion as the deputy mayor for the Queen's birthday, which was run by the Eastern Village History Group. So the community are involved with the group, and they do it regularly. There has been other occasions where the rugby club itself has been in works with lots of different organisations. It's raised money for the likes of Clare House, Help for Heroes, and many others. Frank, these were mentioned by certain people who spoke before. They tried to put a completely negative aspect on what goes on. What I can say is that the rugby club itself is the only one in the Wirral Peninsula that is affiliated by the Rugby Union Federation for training people. And given that we pride ourselves on the 20 pledges, I think it's one of the things that we should be proud of and we should be promoting more. The one thing that did come to my knowledge last weekend when I was down at the rugby club watching all these fabulous young people getting fit was that the age range was from 5 to 15. And at the end of that game, at the end of their training and playing, it was actually a ladies' game. Which I thought was absolutely fantastic to see. maybe to get themselves fit in different ways and different formats. One of the benefits of allowing this application to go ahead is that the application does provide for male and female changing facilities. At the present moment, there's only one set of changing facilities in the old club. So there's a huge benefit for that. And I say traffic problems that are created, we fully supported the conservation group in the problems that we have with traffic and the church in the village itself, because major problems do occur on regular occasions with the amount of traffic in the village. Members have been here a long time and know me speaking about this particular part of the peninsula. It's a medieval layout in the centre, the very narrow roads, the army. The church itself and the rugby club will be far benefited by allowing this application to go ahead, by taking all these vehicles off the highway. Really will. Also, this application, you will have read the section 106 agreement, will actually do something that the conservation people and ward councillors have been fighting for many years, and that is actually reducing the speed of the traffic to this village. So that, again, is a benefit that will accrue the larger community. I think, by and by, all the things that we've put forward in relation to the benefits far outcrew the opposite. This is definitely something that will benefit the whole of the Eastern community and further afield by allowing the new youth hub and community centre to be built in this particular area. There are two major crossings at either end of this particular site that you can see on the A41 and above Pelican crossings. The one to the north, as you look now, is the cars and cycle route. So it's a well-organised, well-designed area for allowing people to cross in safety from one side of the A41 to the other. I don't think there's anything else I can add than the amount of work that's got been put forward, the amount of benefits it will accrue to the wider community of Britain and beyond by allowing this application to go ahead. And I would implore every member to read the recommendation set by the officer. Thank you, Madam.
I understand the Heritage Champion wants to speak on this. Would you like to come forward?
I'm just kind of grievous because I'm fairly unprecedented in my long time service on the planning committee. I did not believe when the Heritage Champion Bill was created that would give them the right to speak on every single planning application and heritage implications. And I just really at that position, it is something new and it's confused me somewhat. So I'm leaving with that impression.
Thank you, Steve. It was actually new to me too, so I did seek some legal advice on this, and I'll leave the legal representative to respond to that.
Yes, the right of any member to speak is at the discretion of the chair, so I did point out that the chair could decide whether or not the heritage champion would give the opportunity to speak, and she felt that was the right thing to do.
Okay, so in the openness of transparency, would you like to say your name and if you switch the microphone on as well?
It's Councillor Jerry Williams, so the Heritage Champion. Thank you for your time this evening. Part of my role as Heritage Champion is to defend historic environments. The issue is, Eastham is a conservation area. It lies within the Greenbelt. The importance of heritage tourism and the visitor economy is highlighted recently in a survey. 85% of the people who visited Wills said they liked Wills for its history, heritage and culture. Eastham is Wills' oldest surviving village, and mentioned in the Doomsday Book, it has played key roles in the Goss River traffic for 800 years, and with the stagecoaches that used to ply between Eastham Ferry and Chester since 1750. The revised management plan states, historic village dating back to before the Doomsday Survey. The village is centred around the church dated from the 1300s. Wider village importance as an 18th century recreational destination, with many of the buildings in the village centre built or used to support travellers. The village has grown up gradually over time with no one architectural style or historical period dominating. The historic village has retained a degree of separation from neighbouring suburban areas by means of green buffer, playing fields, landscape gardens and agricultural areas. This could be destroyed by this application. Roads are narrow and slightly winding, following a medieval street pattern. I am concerned as Heritage Champion of the increased use of the phrase very special circumstances to excuse the degradation of conservation areas and green belts. Again, closing my old, my late colleague Councillor Walter Smith, once it's gone, it's gone. Officers say the arguments are finely balanced, so why recommend approval when there is doubt? Again, we witness the total inability of the highways departments to object to dangerous planning applications on traffic grounds and the ensuing misery it is causing residents for their safety with large amounts of traffic movements. Add to that, exhaust gases pumped into the atmosphere, and I personally witnessed the damage these objections, these non-objections have caused. And in relation to the planning officers, why recommend applications when there is so much evidence to refuse? So I urge the committee to refuse this application, it will cause irreparable damage to the village and change its character forever. Thank you.
To come back on some of the points that were made regarding the highways, because it has been mentioned by several people. Okay.
Thank you. Through you, Chair. This application will create 140 plus car parks, so that will assist in getting the vehicles off the road associated with the rugby club. That's been a particular issue for quite a long time that we've not been able to resolve, so we have asked for a section 106 if this were to be approved, which would allow us to introduce a 25 mile speed limit through the village on Eastern Village Road, Stanley Road, and that would include the necessary signing, road markings, and alterations to the existing vehicle activated signs there, so that it picks up on vehicles that are speeding in excess of 20 miles an hour. In terms of traffic generation, understand 100 vehicles a day seems like a high number, but in highways terms spread throughout the day, that's not a significant number that I feel could be used to sustain an objection on the grounds of the increased traffic through the village. So, on balance, I don't feel there are any sustainable grounds to object to this application on highway safety information.
Thank you. Can I open it up to committee, please? Steve?
I think it's a really, really interesting application, and for us nerds on planning, it really offers a number of challenges. Just to go through some of the issues. Conservation and a conservation area doesn't mean there's no development will ever be allowed in a conservation area. In many